Are we good, Michael? I'm going to turn that on so I don't forget to do that. You know, I heard Naomi told me about a recent survey that, women that put on weight, actually, statistics have shown that women that put on a little extra weight live longer than the men who tell them about it. You guys thought, everybody's like, what's the other one? I don't know. This and end is funny, but it's funny to me. I was telling him yesterday at our breakfast, I was saying how the statistics have shown that 9 out of 10 people like bacon and the other one's lying. Right. Now, I do have a joke here. This is from Richard. I thought it was cute. I thought it was really cute. It says, a husband took his wife dancing. They saw a man out on the floor living it up. Break dancing, moonwalking, the works. The lady looks at their husband and says, see that guy, the wife asked? He proposed to me 25 years ago, but I turned him down. The husband replied, looks like he's still celebrating. You know, there's certain things you say and certain things you don't say. I'm learning in this marriage thing. Like, I've learned that, you know, you say, well, what shoes do you like, honey? I say, they're both cool. You know, I have learned I like that one. And even when it's wrong, you just got to have a decision. You know, you can't just say they're both good. You know, what lipstick do you like? I said, I'm learning. I have an opinion, but I'm very careful with my opinion. Are you here? This is a marriage. You didn't know he's having a marriage seminar today. No, it's all funny, isn't it? Hallelujah. Let's get started. Matthew chapter 22, verse 29 is where we were last week. I want to mention that to you again. I've just entitled this message, How God Loves. Obviously, this message could be going on for eternity, and it will be. Amen. I mean, there's no way that in 40-some minutes or what you're going to describe the magnitude of God's love for us. And, you know, and everything in this walk is contingent upon a revelation of how much God loves you and how much God loves me. Amen. God loves me. He loves me. God loves you, but I'm not saying it for you. You got to say it for you. Amen. You got to personalize it to yourself. And the Bible even says in Galatians 5:6 that faith actually works by love. Faith is energized or becomes operative when you have a revelation of how much God loves you. Do you know everything that God gives us is so he can use that to help you and I see how much he loves us. Amen. Like, for example, excuse me, people say, well, you got to study your Bible. You don't have to study your Bible. You get to study your Bible. And when you study it, if you're seeing it with Jesus glasses on, you're seeing how much God loves you. You're not seeing it as a bunch of laws you have to keep. Excuse me. You're seeing it as the very life of God that keeps you. Amen. 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 There's a big difference. For years, I read the Bible and I saw all these things that I wasn't doing right. Amen. And then I went to church and they told me all these things I wasn't doing right. In fact, they pointed them out. And I said, man, I just read that. You're right. And it became all about me. And I was consumed with myself without even realizing it. I told you the story about the man who he went to church growing up. And he said, somebody asked him one time, they said, hey, what do y'all believe down there at that church? He said, well, I'll tell you what. We don't believe women ought to cut their hair. We don't believe this. We don't believe that. We don't believe you ought to go to the movies. We don't believe this. He goes, finally, I realized we didn't believe anything. We were unbelievers. We were defined by what we didn't believe rather than what we do believe. And seeing Christianity is not about what you don't do. It's about who you know. Amen. And seeing what I'm finding out more and more in my relationship with God, that all the want to is in him. Amen. The Bible says in Philippians chapter 2, I believe it's the end of verse 12 and end of verse 13. He says to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, with reverence. Now, I'm not going to go into all that, but it's work it out, not work for it. Amen. And then he says, for it's God who's working in you. Say, it's God who's working in me, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Amen. God's working in us. Amen. not because we've earned the right for God to work in us, but because we're in Jesus. Amen? Amen? The Bible says you're accepted in the Beloved, Ephesians 1:6. You're highly, highly favored. Now, you can't grasp that with your natural mind. It takes a revelation of the Holy Ghost to show you the magnitude of God's love. And He'll continue doing that throughout the ages to come. May as well let Him start now. Amen? God wants to woo you with His love. Amen. I was thinking, growing up, I'm the oldest of six kids. We're only 9 years apart from oldest to youngest. And taking my younger brothers, I would take them when I was a kid. I remember because I had my license and they were still little kids yet, so to speak. The youngest one, you know, he thinks baby means being immature, but we're trying to get that over to him. That's just not what it means. But I would take them places. And I remember I would do that because I love to just woo them. I still, with my own kids, I love to woo them. I love to bless them. I love them to be excited about going somewhere or doing something. Don't you love that? Now, how much more God? You know, He created this vast creation just to woo you and I. I mean, they're still discovering species of animals just on this planet that they don't even know about. Not to mention the vastness of the universe. You know, that's all been created. The Father just wants to woo you. He just wants you to go, wow, because He loves you. Amen? I don't know if that made any sense to you, but it blessed me. Matthew 22, verse 29. We'll pick up where we was last week. How God loves. Jesus answered, that's good, but I want the King James, if you don't mind. That's just fun. I like the Message Bible. Jesus answered and said unto them, you do err. And then he tells there's two reasons why people err or get off course or wander from the way of understanding. Two reasons. He said, not knowing the scriptures. Amen. And knowing the scriptures isn't just being able to quote them. Knowing the scriptures is knowing the scriptures as they reveal Jesus. Amen. I'm a quick review. Just everybody say quick. That holds me to it. All right. And then we'll come back to this verse. Jump over to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 21. 1 Peter 1, 21. All these are good verses. I'll tell you what, this morning I was meditating on the Word and praying in the Spirit like I do. And I told my wife on the way to church, man, I love the Word. God, I love it. I mean, it's my life. I love it so much. That's Jesus. Amen? Amen. All right. Who by Him, I've talked about this verse a while back, but this is so amazing. It says, who by Him or through Him, referring to Jesus, do believe in God. Now, we can just camp there. See, what He's saying, our belief in God needs to be through Jesus. Amen. Amen. I tell people this all the time. The spirit of Antichrist is not anti-God. It's anti-Christ. It's pro-God, but anti-Christ. Oh, somebody hear that. See, that's why it's so deceptive. Because it's pro-God. I'll tell you, you know, I go by church signs sometimes. Like I went by one sign one time and it was, you know, the AV, authorized version, 1611. It's perfect. Why change it? And I thought, what have you been smoking? You know, that's what I think to myself. But see, it all sounds good. You know, I went by another one the other day. God, the birds are chirping, the grass is green, God did it again. And I don't even know what they mean by that, but God set the world in motion. God's not deciding, maybe I'll green the grass up this spring. God's not doing that. Seed time and harvest, the world's been set in motion. Are you hearing that? God's not up there pulling the puppet strings deciding, maybe I'll make that flower bloom. God set it in motion. But see, that's religious mindsets. Religious mindsets that, well, if God wants it done, it'll get done. Who's ever heard that foolishness? That's not scriptural. God doesn't want anybody to perish, but all to come to the knowledge of the truth. But multitudes perish. It's God's will that every man be saved. That's what it says. But multitudes are not. Are you hearing that? But see, religion wants you to believe that it's just all up to God. If it was up to God, this world would not be experiencing the curse. God gave Adam a will. And God does not violate a person's will. That's huge. Anyhow, who by Him or through Him do believe in God. So how do I believe in God? How do I know the scriptures? It's through Jesus. It's through Jesus. It's through Jesus. Amen. Amen. That raised him up from the dead and gave him glory. Well, we're going to talk about glory. That your faith and hope might be in God. See, if I'm not believing in the Lord through Jesus, I'm not going to have a lot of faith and hope in God. Because if my faith and hope is in me, guess what? It's going to be a tough cookie to sell. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's going to be tough. See, who by him, through Jesus, I believe in God, that raised him up from the dead and gave him glory. Now, wait a minute. I thought he already had glory. Some people don't get this stuff. God gave Jesus glory for you and I. He already had glory before the foundation of the world. See, if you don't have this stuff, your theology is going to be messed up. If your theology is messed up, your life will be messed up. Oh, it may not be messed up now, but down the road. Amen? All right, watch this. He gave him glory so that your faith and hope might be in God. I can have my faith and hope that God's going to come through for me because my faith is in God through Jesus. I'm accepted in the Beloved. I'm highly favored because of what Jesus did through me, for me, and literally as me. Glory to God. Keep going, and we'll be back. Seeing you have purified your souls. Notice it's not your spirit. Through obeying the truth through the Spirit, unto unfeigned or unhypocritical love of the brethren, see that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. Now that would be impossible to do if it wasn't for what Jesus has done. Amen. Now, moving right along, don't really mean to camp here. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Now, two more verses to end this chapter, and I want us to see this. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man is as the flower of grass. All of man's great accomplishments. You know, I look at people and famous people and I think they were really famous in their day, but guess what? They're not even here now. You know, the smart person is the person who lives for eternity. And see, eternity starts right now. Amen. I read a book or been reading parts of this book. It's called Intramuros. It's about a lady's dream of heaven from like the 18th century. And she said something there that rocked my world. She said, the next life, when you cross over, is just a continuation of what you got going on in this life. They're not separate. Amen? You just continue. If you're building on the foundation of Jesus and relationship with God, it just continues on, man. Amen? It's not like you cross over and all of a sudden, wow, starting all over again. It ain't like that. Hallelujah. For all flesh is as grass. All the glory of man is the flower grass. The grass withers and the flower thereof falleth away. One more verse. But the word of the Lord, rhema of the Lord, endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. The Greek literally says, this is the word which is preached as gospel unto you. Now, what's your point, Chris? You can preach the scriptures as law, or you can preach the scriptures as gospel. Hear the difference? He said, this word is to be preached as gospel unto you. Now, quickly, back to Matthew chapter 22. Boy, I'm excited. Golly, I'm excited. Could someone turn them fans on? It's hotter than a horse up here. I'm about ready to get my headband out. Thank you. Jesus answered and said unto them, you do err, not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of God. See, when you know, the key to knowing the power of God is knowing the scriptures. And what is the power of God? See, we think, well, you believe in miracles. That's part of it, but that's not necessarily, that in itself is not, it's much more broad than that, is what I'm trying to say. We'll come back here. Jump over to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5. Watch this. Having a form of godliness, it talks about these people, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. The word power there, and the word in Matthew 22, 29 is dunamis, and it means strength, ability. It means God's ability, God's power, God's strength, God's ability. And it talks about religious people that have a form of godliness, which means like have you ever seen I know you nature people, but have you ever been out in the woods or something and you see where some grasshopper or something, they're where they shed their skin. You know what I'm talking about? Or they, or some ant, a snake or something, shed their skin. You see that? All that is a form. Amen? That's not the actual animal. That's not the grasshopper. That's not the insect. It's just the form. And that's what he's saying here. These people have a form of godliness, but the word denying there is the Greek word arneomai. Say that with me, arneomai. Arneomai. That sound good? Arneomai. What's your name? Arneomai. What's your name? It's not arneomai. But arneomai means to say no to, the power. And the word to the strength or the ability of God. It's the power of the new birth. Amen? You know this new birth has changed you? Amen. Do you know that every command in the New Testament is a call to draw from the grace of God that's in you? Did you know that? To draw from this unlimited well of ability that you have in your born-again spirit. Did you know that? Amen. Matthew 22, 29, quickly, and then we're going somewhere else. People err because they do not know the scriptures, nor the power or the ability or the dunamis of God. Now jump over to a verse we was at last week from the Message Bible, Ephesians 5, 1 and 2. Oh, this is good. We got some good stuff to say. I'm excited about this. Hallelujah. I got so many things here. Watch this. Watch what God does, and then you do it like children who learn proper behavior from their parents. Boy, you could just camp here. Do you know most people don't have a, with God, they don't have a parental relationship. They don't understand that God is their father. I'm talking about born again people. Amen. They still relate to him like he's God of judgment, like he's a God that's ready to smack you down, like he's half ticked off at you. Amen. Are you ready to rock? Because I'm going to talk to you about your identity today. Now we think, see, the first way God that God loves is that he wants you to understand your identity. Right. You're not a servant. You are a son. And when I say son, I'm saying a daughter. I'm saying a child of his. You're his offspring. Amen. How many of you know that if you're in the family, you got certain rights that other people that are not in the family don't have? Are you ready? Say, yes, I'm ready.
Yes.
Okay, we're going to come right back here. But I want to give you an example of how we tend to not understand our relationship with God. I'm going to show you two comparative, everybody say comparative, in the book of Luke. Two comparative statements. We'll start, I'm going to show you this out of Luke 18. We'll begin with verse 1, and then we're going to be in Luke 11. I want to share something with you. Because if you see this, this is life-changing. See, we imitate God as children, not as servants. We imitate God as someone we are, not someone we're trying to be. Mm-hmm. Hear the difference. Amen. This is huge. Now watch this. Now, I'm going to go through this one quick, and then we'll go a little slower on when we get to Luke 11. And Jesus spake a parable. He spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Next verse. Saying, there was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. Next verse. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, she's bothering me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. Next verse. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge saith. Now stop. Is God an unjust judge, yes or no?
No.
No. So here's my point, and I'll finish this quickly, but I want to say this to you. This is a comparative parable. Jesus is showing them, and I'll show you that here in a minute, that God is not unjust. Just the opposite. Watch. Next verse. And shall not God, see here it's comparative. If an unjust judge will give in to this widow who wears him out by her continual coming to him and nagging at him, et cetera, how much more shall not God avenge his own elect? You're the elect.
Amen.
Amen. If you're born again, you are the elect.
Yeah, right.
And if an unjust judge in this world will give in to somebody that just batters him and keeps coming at him, how much more? Are you getting it? Now watch this. It's going to get gooder. Not good English, but you know what I mean. And shall not God avenge his own elect which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them. Next verse. I tell you, here it is, that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? Look at that first part. I tell you, God shall avenge them speedily. Amen. See, he's trying to get you to, this is comparative. Understand that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were transitional. Jesus came under the law, born under the law, but he was fulfilling the old covenant and he was declaring the kingdom of God. Do you know that the Lord's Prayer is actually a transitional prayer? Did you know that? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. If you are born again, according to Colossians 1:13, you have been translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear Son. The kingdom has come. The kingdom is in you. Amen. If you're born again. Amen. Now, I'm not saying, you know, we are still in our physical body. I get all that. That's not what I'm after. But I'm saying the Gospels are transitional from old covenant to new covenant. Now, watch this. Now, so this parable that Jesus said, he's showing them it's a comparison. If an unjust judge would operate like this because of someone's continual coming, how much more God, his own elect, his own children, how much more because of his love for you? See, the problem is we don't know how much God loves us. I challenge you. I've been pacing the floor, praying at night, and just, God, show me your love. Show me what this is. Let me have it as a revelation in my heart and not just in my head. You know, you don't have to even know how to pray. He'll show you how to pray. Isn't that good news? Amen. Hallelujah. So go now, jump over here. And we're going to go back to Ephesians 5:1 from the Message, but jump over to Luke chapter 11, verses 5 through 8, I believe it is. Luke chapter 11, watch this. And he said unto them, which of you shall have a friend? And shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. Next verse. For a friend of mine in his journey has come to me and I have nothing to set before him. Next verse. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. Now stop. I want to just say some things. I have preached this. See, you go to God at midnight. Somebody's come to you and you're out there, man. And you just, you knock on the door and because of your importunity or your shamelessness, God gets up or the man gets up. He gives you what you need. That's not what he's talking about. Remember what we just looked at in Luke 18. It's comparative. Say, this is comparative. Now watch this. This will rock your world. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. Now stop. What does children imply? Who is the guy on the inside? If they're children, who would the guy be? Father. Why do we always think we're the guy on the outside? Why don't we get a revelation that we're the children on the inside? We're not outside at midnight beating on the door. We're on the inside with our Father in a place of rest called the bed. Oh, my, my, my. Somebody get this. You're not on the outside. One person has to persist and work it and stuff like that. All the children have to do is whisper, Daddy, he's right there. Amen. You're not on the outside. You're on the inside. Next verse. Oh, hallelujah. I say unto you, though he will not rise and give him because he is his friend, yet because of his importunity, he will rise and give him as many as he needeth. Now stop. If a friend on the outside who's persistent and shameless can come to his friend at midnight, how much more the children who are on the inside? Who's got children here? Who's ever had children? Who's ever been a child? Let's get everybody in this. I guarantee you, if your children need something, it does not matter what time of night it is. You get up and you do it. If you're a good parent, you do, you do. I mean, man, I've been up at all hours of the night, right? And what are you doing? You're just like this. You're taking sheets downstairs. Somebody threw up. Something went on. You know the drill. Amen? But see, we haven't identified with being children on the inside and in the nice warm house. We've been identifying with, I'm that guy outside. Boy, if I just knock longer. I just need 3 loaves. I just need this. We're outside at midnight of all times, a dark time. You're not outside, man. You are inside. Amen. See, religion has caused us to identify with the man on the outside instead of the one on the inside. Man, that's good. That's good stuff. Now back to Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Hallelujah. You're on the inside. You're in the inner circle. Hallelujah. Watch what God does and then you do it. Now, how can I watch what God does if I'm the guy on the outside? I can't see. The door's shut. The door's been open for you. Amen. Watch what God does and then you do it. Like children who learn proper behavior from their parents. But if I'm on the outside, how can I see what God does on the inside? Oh, somebody hear this. How can I see what he's doing if I'm on the outside, a door, if there's a door? You ever heard anybody say, people say this to me all the time, hey, you make a better window than you do a door. Or how do they say it? You make a better door than you do a window, something like that. In other words, I'm blocking their view. That's the part I got. Amen. So, but see, I can't see what God does if I'm outside, and especially if it's midnight. It's dark. Amen. I'm just trying to get bread to help someone else out. See, I preached that for years. I thought, man, that's who we are, man. We just got to keep, man, we just got to batter God. And I'll tell you what, if we just twist God's arm, he'll do something. How many people are praying for revival? You ever had an all-night prayer meeting? Am I the only one? You pace the floor and all night. And listen, I'm not saying you can't have, if it's the right with the right heart, but I'm saying so much of this is we're trying to twist God's arm. Oh God, pour out your spirit, pour out revival. God poured out his spirit on the day of Pentecost. You can't find any record where he ever took his spirit back. God's saying, you go tell people that the sin debt's been taken care of. Amen. Hallelujah. I look, even sometimes I go to the nursing home because, man, I just fire both barrels, new covenant. I mean, hard as I can. I could just see religion. It's amazing because, people people that are like trying to understand what you're saying. I mean, it almost sounds like you're saying God dealt with the sin issue. That's exactly what I'm saying. That's what God's saying. There's nothing between you and God. There's nothing you can do that's greater than the blood of Jesus. Nothing. You can screw your life up. You can go to jail. You can do dumb things. I don't recommend it. It's stupidity. It's not who you are. Amen. But I'm telling you, if you get a revelation of his blood, that's the power of what Jesus did. See, it's all about Jesus. I was thinking the other night as I was praying, I think my only part is to believe that he did it all. That's it. And I'm saying, that's why I study the word. That's why I pray. That's why. And I was thinking, Lord, that's awesome. Help me believe that, amen, that you did it all. I mean, wow. Wow. I was thinking, last night I was thinking about, and I think about this a lot when I pray, and where Jesus said, in that day, talking about the day of the new birth, John 16, 23 and 24, you'll ask me nothing. He says, whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you that. And then it goes on to say, hitherto, Jesus said, have you asked nothing in my name? Ask and that your joy may be full. And I thought, my word, God wants my joy full. That glorifies him. That glorifies God when my joy's full. And I started thinking, how religious am I? I mean, I sit there and think, well, that's really not humility. I mean, come on. I mean, you're joyful. And I mean, that sounds a little selfish. Doesn't it sound selfish? It's not selfish. God gets a kick out of seeing you blessed. That's why he said, Jesus saying, you don't have to ask me. You ask the Father. Give the Father an excuse to treat you just like Jesus. Amen. That's his goal. That glorifies him. I could give you other scriptures that should show you that. That glorifies God. Hallelujah. Who wants to glorify God? Amen. I do. Well, then let him love on you. Let him lavish his love and his gifts and his things on you. That's how God gets glory. He gets. I sometimes kick into redneck and hillbilly because watch what God does. We're on the inside. Say, I'm on the inside. And then you do it. Like children who learn proper behavior from their parents. Next verse. I love this. Mostly what God does is love you. Now, see, I used to think that mostly what God does is tell me what I need to do. Amen? Mostly what God does is tell me how sorry I am. Anybody else? And then at church, they kept telling me the same thing. I said, well, that's it, man. You're right. I just need to be more zealous. That's my problem. Amen? I was determined to be the most zealous person on the planet because I love God. I heard a grace preacher say years ago, he said, you know, it's the people that love God the most that get the most condemned. The people who don't care, who cares? Eat, drink, and be merry. Tomorrow we die. I mean, get all you can get, can all you can get, and sit on the can. You know what I mean? I mean, why care? But it's when you really love God. In fact, I was going to move to Lima, Ohio before I got married, me and another guy, and we were just going to live together, and we were going to hold revivals all over the city. We were going to just do that. I mean, we were zealous, man. That was our goal. That was our dream, because it was all about what we did. But then I find out it ain't about what you do. It's about what he did. In fact, what I tell people is not what they're doing. It's what he did. Let me put it to you this way. Here's how an old covenant preacher will act. When you mess up, when you sin, an old covenant preacher will say, look what you've done. A new covenant preacher will say, look what he's done. Hear the difference? See, old covenant points you to you. New covenant points you to Jesus. That's why it's good news. Hallelujah. I was always saying, does that mean it doesn't matter how we live? Not on God's end. But for the world, if you live like a bozo, and I believe you're miserable too because you're living contrary to your nature. The old Brother Hagin used to say, you know, it's kind of like taking a shower with your socks on. Something just ain't right. Right? Can't figure out what's going on here, but something ain't right. Mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with him and learn a life of love. You can't learn a life of love if you don't keep company with him. And you can't keep company with him if you're the guy on the outside at midnight when it's dark and you're beating on the door. Hear the difference? See, you keep company with him knowing you're on the inside. Hallelujah. You know, our children learn things by the way Jen and I act. That's why when you see them screaming and throwing a fit, know where they've learned it from. When you see them cool, calm, and collective, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. Okay. So keep company with him and learn a life of love. Jump over to the King James. We'll come back here in the Message Bible. But jump over to Acts chapter 4, verse 13, and watch this. Hallelujah. I am not accomplishing what I got here, but I got a little bit of it done. Praise God. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled, and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. You cannot be with Jesus in relationship and not change. It's impossible. See, that's why all this fear of like, oh, if you tell people God's not mad at them, they're going to go crazy. Paul Ellis had a quote I thought was really good. He said, the only people that abuse grace are the people who see God as their judge and not as their father. And I thought, that is awesome. The only people that abuse grace are the people who see God as a judge and not as their father. How much can I get away with? Hallelujah. You can't hang with Jesus and not change. It's impossible. It's impossible. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2, Message Bible. Ephesians, look at this. Chapter 5, verse 2 from the Message again. Mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with him and learn a life of love. Now, that's something we do. We keep company with him. But it starts by a change of mind. Knowing the power of God is seeing the power of God. Seeing the power of God is knowing you're in the house and not outside. See, a lot of what people do, even preachers, is they mimic what they've heard rather than who they know. You know what I love about my relationship with God? This may sound so simple to you, is I've noticed as I grow, it's about my relationship with him. Not about my relationship through Andrew Womack or Creflo Dollar or Joseph Prince, as much as I love those guys, love all three of them, awesome. But as much as I love those guys, and I thank God for them, and as much as they encourage me and others, there's others, not just those. You know, the big three you thought was Ford, GM, and Chrysler. It's not. It's Creflo, Andrew, and Joseph. All right. Actually, it's Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, but that's on. But my whole point in saying that is it's my relationship. Amen? It's not through someone else. What if you were married to someone and all you did was read about that person or listen to people who told you about that person, but you never spent time with that person? You'd have a lot of great information about that person, but I guarantee you wouldn't know that person. See, this is why Jesus and Paul talked about prayer so much. Prayer is plugging into the power of God. The Lord told me something so profound. He said, true prayer is the act, everybody say the act, of glorying in my weaknesses so the power of Christ can tabernacle or rest upon me, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. True prayer. It's like we're all equipped. We're like this appliance. We're like this vacuum sweeper. We're an awesome vacuum sweeper. We're sitting in the middle of the thing, but God wants, hey, so plug it in. The Holy Ghost will plug you in. The Word will, you plug in and the power flows through you. Amen? Positionally, you're plugged in. But you know you need to, and let the power flow. And it comes by knowing you're on the inside, babe. You are on the inside. You're not on the outside. So mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with Him and learn. Somebody say learn. A life of love. See, I used to hear that, well, you just need to love people, Chris. That's your problem. You just need to love people. And boy, I could look at my life and say, that is true. I need to love people more. Amen? But now the key is to keep company with Him, and I will learn a life of love. Amen. See, the reason people don't hear God a lot of times is they're on the wrong frequency. They think God's boy, I'll tell you what, He's just going to give you a bunch of rules and He's going to pound you and all those kind of stuff. And the whole time, mostly what He does, He just loves on you. Hallelujah. Observe how Christ loved us. Now, how do I observe that? The Word will tell me. Amen. His love was not cautious, but extravagant. Boy, do I love that. God's love is not cautious. God's blessing upon you is not cautious. Well, I'm going to give them a little bit and then see what they do. Think of Adam and Eve before the fall. God gave them all authority with no strings attached. I would have had some strings attached. I would have had a clause, but if you do eat of the tree that I told you not to eat of, cancel everything. We're starting over. God never did that. And God doesn't do that with you and I. Isn't that amazing? God trusts. Let me say it to you this way. God has faith in you. I mean, that's a new wrinkle in your brain. God has faith in me. God believes in you. Wow. Hallelujah. His love is not cautious but extravagant. He didn't love in order to get something from us, but to give everything of Himself to us. Love like that. Now, this is amazing. In other words, there was no motives. God's love, there wasn't like, you know how people, like, I'm going to be nice to this person. But what's the catch? What's the motive? God had none of that. God had none of that. I am convinced that many people have a mindset in their relationship with God that it's kind of like people. What's the catch? What's the catch? Amen? Amen. So the first way and the first mindset that we need to repent of, and I'm going to give you some things here on repentance, we need to repent of this mindset that thinks we're on the outside of the house, beating on the door, and realize we're on the inside of the house in bed with the Father. We're in a place of rest. It's warm. It's cozy. It's not cold. It's not dark. Amen? That's powerful. All right. Now, I want to say a few things to you about repentance, because this is good. So many people think repentance is this act where you've got to cry, you've got to bawl. And I realize a lot of you in here have heard that the word for repent means to change your mind, metanoia. I know you've heard that. I am familiar with that. But there's a scripture in the Bible that used to bug me. Are you ready for it? You ever had any scriptures in the Bible bug you? Am I the only one? You ever read your Bible? It's a joke. Amen. I like what Jim and Dodie say. They, they think everyone's crazy. They'll say to each other, Jim will say to Dodie, he said, I think everyone's crazy except us, and I'm having my doubts about you. That's funny. I don't care who you are. I shouldn't have done that because now I forgot where I was. Anyhow, here it is. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10. This verse used to bug me. Do you know that when at John's baptism, was a baptism unto repentance or change of mind? Now, I always thought that meant that, like water baptism, I always thought, well, you get baptized from all your sins. And there's an element of truth there. I'm not totally negating that. But I'm saying, really, baptism has to do with a complete new way of thinking. That instead of trusting in myself, that's what John's baptism was, the baptism of repentance, water baptism. That now, instead of trusting in my own ability, I'm now changed my mind to where I'm trusting in his ability. Now, this verse used to bug me. Did it ever bug you? For godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of. Boy, I got to get salvation here because it's really good. It's on my phone. I want to read it to you. But for godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of. But the sorrow of the world worketh death. And I always thought, what in the world is he talking about? I want to give you salvation here because it is just rock and roll good. There's something that he says in here that I want you to see. What did I say? 2 Corinthians 7:10. Okay, watch this. Some of these days I'm going to get these up on the screen. Salvation, the soteria. But here's the difference. He says, godly sorrow works repentance or a change of mind which produces a change of action. Let me say this to you. Repentance is not a change of action. Change of action is a fruit of repentance. Repentance is a change of mind that produces a change of action. You got to get that. Why is that important? Because if you think repentance is a change of action, you'll change your actions thinking you repented when you've never changed your mind. Hear the difference? Right believing produces right living. Repentance is a change of mind. The fruit of repentance is change in action. Now notice what it says here. Soteria is the Greek word for salvation. This is what I wanted you to say. It means deliverance, preservation, safety, salvation, and here's what I was after. Deliverance from the molestation of enemies. I love that. Deliverance from the molestation or being molested by enemies. You know, when people are dealing with depression and fear and torment and panic attacks, do you know you're being molested by the enemies of the kingdom of God? Now, okay, thanks, Jen. Okay, but godly sorrow, notice what it says, works a repentance to salvation that you don't have to change your mind from that. And I thought, well, what is the difference, Lord, between godly sorrow and the sorrow of the world? And I felt like he told me. See, godly repentance is turning to in your thinking. You turn to God. The sorrow of the world is you turn from something that's wrong, but you don't turn to God. See, it's called behavior modification. Many people, New Year's resolution is be a good example. How many of those have we made? I'm not going to do this, or I'm going to do this, or I'm going to exercise more. All those things. And that works for what? 2 days? 2 weeks if, at the most? You know what I'm saying? Why? Because it was a worldly sorrow. It was a sorrow that didn't produce a connection with God. But see, when you turn to God, you automatically turn from whatever it is that's not right. Hear the difference? See, repentance is something God gives you. Did you know he even gives you that? Because he loves you. See, the problem, we got to change our minds about some of the ways we think about God. All right. Amen. So the sorrow of the world turns from something, but it doesn't turn to something. And it starts in the way you think. Amen? How much time do I got? None. Okay. Okay. All right. I wanted to do the main thing that we need in allowing God to love us is we need to stop our communion with legalism. Stop our communion with, we need to devour the love of God. I heard a guy say it. Man fell by partaking and eating of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. In the new covenant, we are to partake or eat of what Jesus has done. It's been said that we ate our way into this problem. We can eat our way out. Some of you going, amen, brother. That's good preaching. All right. Can I give you quick one more? Is that okay? Just one more quick? Quick? I'm so good. Okay. Okay, got it? Ephesians 6:16. Watch this. Because I got some Greek words written here that I want you to. Ephesians 6:16. Above all, taking the shield of faith, this is the armor of God, wherewith we shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. We shall be able to quench. Now keep that back to verse 16. I just want you to see this. Now above all means out in front of all, we take what? The shield of faith. The shield of faith. Faith in what? What Christ has done. Now here was my question. What are the fiery darts of the wicked? What are the fiery darts of the wicked? I used to think it was, man, I had a bad thought. That was not a good thought. I had a bad thought. Those are not the fiery darts of the wicked. Those are a result of the fiery darts of the wicked. We're seeing how God loves us. See, he's wanting us to repent from some things. He wants us to change our mind so we won't be tormented by thoughts. We won't deal with panic attacks, etc., etc. Look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 18. This gets really good. What are the fiery darts of the wicked? The New American Standard Bible says flaming missiles. I think that's amazing. But it says, but you are not come unto the mount or the mountain that might be touched and that burned with what? Nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest. In other words, you haven't come to Mount Sinai. You haven't come. Now watch this. The word there might be touched means to touch even lightly. You haven't come to this. Now he's talking about Mount Sinai. What is Mount Sinai? The law. The law. Next verse. And the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. Next verse. Here. For they could not endure that which was commanded. You know, people still can't endure the law and that which is commanded. Now watch this. And if so much as a beast, an animal, touched the mountain, you could say touch the law. Do you know every time you touch the mountain, Mount Sinai, every time you touch law teaching and law thinking, you give the enemy access to release fiery darts of condemnation and judgment into your life? That's why I said they couldn't even touch it. They couldn't endure. When the law was given in the old covenant, they could not even endure it. And if a beast touched the mountain, it was dead. Everything, are you hearing me? Every time you and I touch the law, every time we touch legalism, we're releasing fiery darts of judgment and condemnation and things into our life. Did you know that? Wow. Hold on. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a what? What did we just read in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 16? Fiery darts of the wicked. Isn't that interesting? So I always thought the darts were just thinking bad thoughts and thinking about some murder movie or some bad movie or something. No, fiery darts are judgment and condemnation. Whenever you touch Mount Sinai, whenever you touch law, that's what's released. Let me just finish this. I'll quit. Oh, there's just so much. Hallelujah. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. Next verse. But here's where you have, you are come unto Mount Sion or Mount Zion, new covenant. You have come right now. You're not coming, you already have come. But we could camp here. And unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels. You know why it's so important to be under the new covenant? Because you're surrounded by an innumerable company of celestial angels that are protecting you. When you operate under law, angels are limited. Why do Christians die early? I think we just seen something here. Amen? They're not supposed to. They go to heaven. God loves them. Hallelujah. Next verse. Here's what you have come to. You've come to the General Assembly and Church of the Firstborn. I would love to preach on the firstborn, but not now. Which are written in heaven, and to God the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect. That's you. That's you. But see, if I'm still out there touching Mount Sinai, all I'm doing is giving the enemy access to these fiery darts of judgment and condemnation into my life. That's why God instructs us through the Word. So what is the key? Back to what we originally started. People err when they don't know the Scriptures in light of what Jesus has done. If you know the Scriptures in light of what Jesus has done, you'll know the power of God. And that's, my friend, is an overview of how God loves you. Amen. God loves you. Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. Amen, amen, amen. You are blessed. Amen. If anybody here is not born again and has never been born again, I want to give you that opportunity. Hallelujah. Anybody? Nobody? Want to get born again again? You can't. I'm kidding. Anybody here, the baptism in the Holy Spirit? We believe in the baptism in the Holy Spirit. You know, the Bible says when you bless with the Spirit, well, I want to go here too, but I'm fighting it. Do you know the Bible says that you bless with the Spirit, the other person's not edified? Like if you pray over your meal and you pray in spiritual language, you know the word bless there? Eulogio actually means you invoke the blessings of God. Paul said, you give thanks well, but the other's not edified. Think about that. You invoke the blessings of God. Hallelujah. So we believe in that. Now, anybody, prayer for healing. Can we hurt somebody so we can pray for their healing? I'm kidding. Teresa's pointing to Mark. Good girl. Mark, you want prayer for something? Stretch your hands towards Mark. Lay hands on him. In the name of Jesus, I curse bronchitis in Mark right now. I command it by the authority of the name of Jesus to go. We release the very life of Jesus Christ into his physical body. In Jesus' name, amen. Anybody else? We are done. There's nobody else. Nobody. What about them flyers? What a bummer. But hey, what? They made it to the Elite Eight, right? Amen. Anybody else? You're done. Give somebody a hug. We love you. Hallelujah.
Lily of the valley, bright morning star, wonderful counselor and friend.